Welcome. My name is Berit Herrström. You are watching the Dry Etch TPT course. This is the second lecture called the Etch Plasmas and Equipment Layout. But first, I'll give you an overview of the whole course. We have the lecture part here, which consists of 6 videos. We have a video on the motivation, why bother about dry etching. Then there's this video here on etch plasmas and equipment layout. We have a video on etch mechanisms, one on etch characteristics, another one on process tuning, and then we have a video that gives an overview of the equipment we have here. To complete the course, you also need to follow the hands-on, which is hands-on training on the equipment in the clean room. But before you do that, you need to watch some screencast videos that we made of the software on these systems. There's also 2 videos showing some of the instruments. It's very important that you have watched these videos carefully before you come to the hands-on. In that way, you'll get more out of the course, and also it will save us a little bit time and spare our voices for repeating the same things over and over again. So please watch the videos. But now we will continue with the etch plasmas and equipment layout. First, what is a plasma? Well, the plasma is said to be the fourth state of matter. You know, when you have a solid and you heat it up, in most cases you will get a liquid. If you keep heating, you will get a gas. If you keep heating on the gas will ionize and you will get a plasma. So the plasma is a freely moving charged particles, positive ions and electrons. An example of that is, for example, the stars. But as you know, the stars are very hot and the plasma is typically between 4,000 and 20,000 Kelvin, depending on what gas it is. And that is a very high temperature, and if you imagine putting your samples into that, they will definitely evaporate and turn into ions as well. So this is not the kind of plasma we are using. So the plasma we are using in dry etching is a weakly ionized plasma, and it's also called a glow discharge plasma. In this kind of plasma, only a very small fraction of the neutrals are formed into ions. It's only about 1 out of 10,000 at the most. And that means that the temperature can be kept down around room temperature, and therefore very useful for etching our samples. So as you see, if there's about 10 to the 15th neutral species per square centimeter, only about 10 to the 9th, or maybe up to 10 to the 11th, ions and electrons per square centimeter. These plasmas are formed electrically. If you imagine having a gas between 2 electrodes, then if you put a certain voltage over the electrodes, electrons will be accelerated from the cathode towards the anode. On their way, they will collide with atoms and molecules and create ions and extra electrons. And then these extra electrons will also take part in collisions, and that way you can create a partly ionized plasma. To break down the gas to plasma, you need a certain breakdown voltage. And this here is a discharge passion curve that's showing the breakdown voltage as a function of the pressure and electrode spacing. But to be able to create the plasma, you need to have a voltage of a certain range. And for that to be not too high, then you need to be within a certain pressure range. And that pressure range is typically in the millitorr to torr range. We're using torr as a unit because that is what is on the systems we have in the laboratory, but you can see some conversion factors here. So we need to be at a quite low pressure, and that means the process has to take place in a vacuum chamber. Not too low vacuum, because then you also need a too high breakdown voltage, but in this millitorr to torr is very typical values. If the pressure gets too high, then the plasma will also be unstable and it will start arcing. So this is not so good. If we take a look at some other collisions taking place in the plasma, we have the ionization, as I mentioned before, but we also have some dissociation, where electrons will collide with molecules and create some neutral species, and these are radicals, and radicals are very reactive. So some of these very reactive species here, they take place in the etching because they really want to react with our sample. There will also be some excitation, where atoms and molecules are excited to a higher state, and when they relax again, they send out light. The light does not take place in the etching, but it can be used for endpoint detection, and it can be used to analyze the plasma for what kind of species is inside. There will also be some recombination, where the radicals go together again and form neutral molecules, or the ions and electrons will recombine also to create neutral molecules. This is of course not what we want in the etching. This is an example of a etching system. This is the reactive ion etcher, also called the parallel plate capacitively coupled reactive ion etcher. It's a quite simple system. It consists of a top electrode here, which is also connected to the side, and this is grounded. And then there's a bottom electrode that is connected to a potential, and this is an AC potential. And if we take a look here, we see that the AC potential is, of course, varying over time. And it is varying very fast at 13.56 megahertz. This is in the radio frequency range, and therefore we also call it the RF potential. You can imagine then when the electrode is then positive, then it will attract the electrons, and when it's negative, it will in principle attract the ions. But because it's varying so fast, the ions are actually too heavy to follow the movement, and they will stand still in the plasma, whereas the electrons are light enough to follow the movement, so they will be attracted to the electrode half of the time. Then you can see here that there's a blocking capacitor in the system, and because that is there, then electrons will build up on the electrode. So after some time, when it has stabilized, then the overall potential on the bottom electrode will be negative. Only a very short period of time will it be positive, so electrons can flow to the electrode. But the average potential is negative and is called the DC potential. Then the plasma potential, which is up here, is a little bit positive. If we look at the potential over the chamber here, then it's positive in the plasma, it's zero at the top electrode, and then it will be in average negative here at the bottom electrode. And this is where we have our sample lying. If we take a little closer look here, close to the electrode, then we see that we have some space between the plasma and the electrode. And that's because the electrode is negative, so most of the time it will repel electrons. And the electrons make the plasma, so the plasma will be confined a little bit away from the bottom electrode. And when there's no collisions taking place down here, then no light will come out, and therefore it's called dark space. It's also called the ion sheath, because as you can see, the ions they will be created up here in the plasma. But when they come close to this boundary, they will feel the negative potential and they will be accelerated from the plasma down to the electrode. And that's why it's called also the iron sheath. But this gives rise to bombarding ions, and these bombarding ions, they are the physical etching. Then, at the same time, we're still creating some neutrals in the plasma, and they will diffuse around in the whole chamber. At some point, they will also get to the surface of our sample, and they will take part in the chemical etching. So we have the physical etching from the bombarding ions and the chemical etching from neutrals that just diffuse around in the chamber. I've now explained how the RE works. That's the system you see here. But most of our systems are actually ICP systems called inductively coupled plasma systems. The difference is that here the plasma is generated by a coil that is around the chamber. And this coil is also connected to an RC potential. This will create a B field that is also time varying. And this will create a current inside here where you have the electrons moving around the chamber without hitting the sidewalls or the bottom and top electrode. In that way you can create a very high density plasma without getting a lot of sputter on the electrodes. And one good thing about it is also that then you can control the density and the ion energy individually. And that is sometimes a good idea. So the main difference is that you get a much higher plasma density in the ICP systems. And you can control the ion energy and the density individually. If we take an overall look at the system, then we have a chamber, a vacuum chamber. In this case, it's an ICP system, so you have the coil and the generator for the coil, and you have a platen generator as well. Then up here, you have different kind of gases. They are all connected to an MFC, a mass flow controller. In that way, you can control the flow of each gas individually. There are some valves controlling if you're letting in the gas or not. And then you have the lines going in here, so you get the gas in typically in the top of the chamber. You also need to control the pressure inside the chamber, and for that you have a pumping system where you pump out the gas again. And inside the pumping system you have this valve, which is a pressure controller. This can be more or less open. When it's fully open you get the lowest pressure, and when it's almost close, you can get a quite high pressure. There's also a pressure gauge that's measuring the pressure inside, and there will be a feedback loop between these two, so you can set a certain pressure in the recipe, and then it will be controlled by, by the pressure controller here. There's also typically a chiller system on, and this is cooling the bottom electrode, so you can control the temperature here. And that's also needed sometimes. So these are the overall view of the different parameters you can play with on the system. It's the gas flows, the pressure, the temperature, and the two powers. So this was the last part of this video here. So you should continue now with a video called Etch TPT Lecture.